cornea.
Thank you, Dr. Rohit. I would like to thank AIOS for this opportunity.
It's not audible.
Am I audible now?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. So there has always been an ongoing debate about who came first, the chick or the egg. Well, as ophthalmologists, we face a similar situation when we talk about keratoconus and eye rubbing, because we don't know whether it is keratoconus that is associated with eye rubbing or it's eye rubbing that actually causes keratoconus. Now, one person who really backs that is Dr. Daniel Gatinel. He says that eye rubbing is a sine qua non for keratoconus. So he totally believes in his mechanical hypothesis of keratoconus versus the previous molecular hypothesis, which says that there is an unknown collagen dystrophy. It's of unknown etiology. He says there's no unknown etiology. It's only one and only one thing, which is eye rubbing. The eye rubbing may be caused by multiple factors, but if you don't have, so he has a paper which says no rub, no cone. If you don't have eye rubbing, you wouldn't have a cone. And he even correlates this eye rubbing with the side on which the patient sleeps, the ocular, the dominant hand which the patient uses in his daily life, other factors like dry eye, allergy, etc. So there are more papers to back this, which talk about how keratoconus, allergies, itching are correlated with that particular dominant hand in that particular patient. So the eye, which has more keratoconus, correlates with the dominant hand of that person. And there are also multiple studies about immunoglobulins in these patients being high. The team from Narayan Netralaya and Dr. Rohit have a particular paper on allergen-specific exposure associated with high IgE levels in these eye rubbers. Now, there are a lot of studies that have already been done extensively in keratoconus to tell us that allergies lead to high matrix metalloproteinase 9. MMP9s can be controlled with target-specific molecules like cyclosporin, and attenuation of lysyl oxidase in patients who are predisposed to keratoconus. But the main thing that we are looking at in any mechanism underlying the keratoconus pathogenesis is the first step, which is the atopy, which is usually associated with eye rubbing. So I would like to thank Dr. Rohit for sharing his data with me. They have a study on the association of serum and tear IgE levels in keratoconus patients with and without allergic eye disease. So all these patients were subjected to clinical evaluations, topography, a tear analysis, and a serum analysis. So apart from tear IgE values, what was also measured was the inflammatory levels of IgE, interleukin-4, and interleukin-13. Now let's take a look at their results. In IgE levels of patients with keratoconus without allergic eye disease, the levels of IgE directly correlate to the increasing grades of severity of keratoconus. So the higher the grade of keratoconus, the higher the IgE level was. If you look at patients with allergic eye disease, all of them had high IgE levels, but there was no real pattern in different grades. And if you look at the tear biomarker profile in patients with or without allergic eye disease, they had high inflammatory molecules. The keratoconus patients with or without allergy had high IgE, had high IL-4 as well as IL-13 as compared to controls. So we know that serum and tear IgE is high. That possibly causes the rubbing and the allergy, which is increasing the inflammation, possibly causing collagen degradation, and that is what leads to keratoconus. Now, let us discuss these two cases particularly, looking at the clinical implication of this entire study. So you have two patients. One is an 11-year-old male with a grade 3 keratoconus and a pachymetry of 410 microns versus a 15-year-old male with a grade 2 keratoconus and 490 microns. We all know that usually these younger age groups have some amount of allergy already in them when they present to us with keratoconus. And also we need to keep in mind that these patients progress much more rapidly than others. So if you are going for a cross-linking, when should you go for it? Should you go in for it immediately? Should you wait? Of course, you will first assess what is the severity of allergic eye disease in them. And typically, we would start them on a battery of medications like steroids, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, cyclosporine, tacrolimus, all of that. most of these patients may come under control. There is still a subset of them who do not come under good control, or they go into remission and then they might recur. So why is this happening? Why are some of them progressing and why not? Now, when we tested the serum IgE levels of these patients, these two in discussion, we saw that the levels were significantly high. A normal should be less than 300, when these patients had 2,700 and 1,730 international units per ml. Keeping this in mind, an immunologist opinion was taken. And the immunologist performed a patch test and found an offending agent for each of them. The first case, there was a sunflower allergy. The mother was using sunflower oil in the cooking for the child. And in the second case, it was a sheep wool allergy because of using of sweaters and woolen clothes. Now, particularly for these two patients, what we first did was we avoided the offending agent and the allergen. So in one case, we stopped the use of sunflower oil, and in the second case, the offending agent stopped wearing the woolen clothes. In addition, you have to give your oral antihistaminic treatment, and these patients were also given sublingual immunotherapy by the immunologist. Both the patients had a significantly reduced allergy after that treatment. So how is this applied to our clinical practice? If you have eye rubbing, atopy, and asthma, you already have a high serum IgE. High would be anything, like I said, more than 300 international units. For these patients, we possibly should look at or should think about giving an immunologist's opinion, because we'd be able to find out an offending agent, which we as ophthalmologists may not sit and be able to do that in our OPD. And that offending agent needs to be avoided. Why? Because we want to wait and then cross-link. And why do we want to wait? Why is it important to treat that IgE before cross-linking? In this, we already have a paper by Dr. Rohit Shetty and his team. Now, lysyl oxidase has been studied by this by them. And what the paper says is that lysyl oxidase is an endogenous cross-linker. In a patient of keratoconus, this lysyl oxidase is reduced. So you want to treat a patient and get a successful outcome. If the lysyl oxidase is reduced, which it is in the presence of inflammation, you are going to have a failed cross-linking. So that is why possibly one patient who undergoes cross-linking has a good outcome, whereas another patient is still progressing even after you have a cross-linking. So what does the future hold? We would ideally want a point of care kit where, just like you have a blood sugar level, you get a test which tells you your serum IgE versus your tear IgE levels. And that possibly could help you screen your patients and decide who you want to send to the immunologist or who you can manage yourself. So this debate is always going to be continuing about keratoconus versus eye rubbing. And I would like to thank Dr. Rohit for this data and his team.
Thank you, Karishma. Few questions which arise from your excellent talk. How close are we, how correlated is the serum IgE to the tear IgE? I know you all are doing the tear IgE levels, but how correlated are they?
So they are increased in both the groups. The serum IgE is high as well as the tear IgE is high in both these groups.
Can you do only a tear IgE and assume therefore that the serum IgE will be high and treat according to just the Schirmer strip measurement of the tear IgE?
I don't think we should only keep that, because we are wanting to look at the systemic evaluation so that we can start systemic treatment, because we're anyways giving topical treatment for the patient who has allergy on the basis of his clinical symptoms. So we should look at something beyond what we can see.
Sir, just to continue from what she said, the serum IG, allergy is a systemic problem. It's not a local issue. Even if you have a patient coming to you with VKC, we only treat the eye, not looking at the systemic issue, which is going to be a very wrong way of looking at it. Because there is systemic issue, but there is also a trigger of a local issue. That means if you have an IgE of say 3000 in the systemic, your IgE in the tears will be maybe 4000 or 1500. This is a small variation, but it's always higher. So what we have seen, like she said, is in the normal person, it correlates quite tightly, but in an allergic patient, based on what his allergen is. For example, you and me, both of us have allergy, and our allergens or not, we are sensitive. Maybe you may be sensitive to this flower, I may be sensitive to this leaves. So that allergen is different. So based on whether you are living in a garden or you're living in a flat, then the allergen specificity increases, and that's when we get local changes.
No, I agree. What I'm trying to say is I'm just trying to eliminate doing a serum IgE at all. I do a tear IgE, it is raised, I send him to an immunologist who does the, or somebody who does the patch test for allergy and treat.
Both you need, sir.
Both you need.
Both you need. It's like getting an RBS and FBS.
Okay.
So you they titrate your allergy based on both of them. Any questions for Dr. Karishma? So,
what about Montelukast as a non-specific anti-allergic, anti-inflammatory?
Absolutely. We would be looking at the entire spectrum of drugs that is available. And like I said, because we don't want to, while sitting in our OPD, apart from giving your topical treatment, if you want to give these drugs, you would ideally want an immunologist. So it is an ideal case situation where you could refer it to them and they will...
See, Montelukast, what happens is, if you have a very non-specific allergy, it works very well. But you have a specific allergy. For example, both of them have the same thing. Like example, I'm allergic only to this plant and I have this whole garden in my house with this plant. Then your anti-allergics and even steroids don't work because you have to take this plant off or you have to have bring in that systemic immune therapy for that.
I'll just to qualify again on Montelukast and antihistaminic. See, whenever you have an acute attack, it's the antihistaminic which brings you down. Forget the allergy. Just imagine a common cold. Somebody suffering from a huge cold, you'll give him an antihistaminic. You will not deny that. But somebody's getting frequent colds, I would put him on a 3-month course of Montelukast 10 milligram at night. You see, the idea is that you can give it as a chronic thing while you don't normally give an antihistaminic as a chronic. So if you're not going to do the immune the studies, if you're not going to do the patch test, find out the specific allergens, as Rohit said. If it's going to be a non-specific allergy that you're treating with and the patient is bad, you can give a 3-month course of Montelukast topped up with antihistaminics as and when there is an acute attack. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. No itching, no keratoconus.
Yes, so there would be some patients who have no history of keratoconus. Why is history of keratoconus? No history of itching.
So what
yes.
you're saying is they have history of keratoconus,
but they don't
rub the eyes.
And the patients who have this keratoconus without rubbing of the eye are the ones who are genetically predisposed. So there is one particular population who is rubbing their eyes and develops keratoconus. There is one who is not rubbing their eyes. So why is that population still developing keratoconus? Those are the ones who are genetically predisposed. There is comes your genetic hypothesis.
Or if you listen to a person called Gatinel ever, he will convince you that everyone rubs their eyes if they have keratoconus, whether you've seen it or you've not seen it. Invisible, at night rubbing, or the way he turns his head on the pillow and sleeps, that causes irritation. Means this gentleman is firmly convinced that it's 100%
yes.
Rubbing which is the cause of keratoconus. We don't go to that extent. We go by what Karishma is saying, which makes more logical sense, that there is some protective gene which is there in some and not there in all.
See, my colleague, and we did a study. We took every patient who comes to our clinic who has a history of eye rubbing, we took a different videos of how they rub the eyes. It's very interesting how you rub your eyes actually drives your progression. Somebody may say, I rub my eyes every day. I don't know whether she has that video. I'll see if I can pick that video. There are some people rub it with knuckles. Some people are very gentle with the rubbing. So more the force you get, the more the progression it is. So it's just not eye rubbing. It's also about how you do it. But severity of itching is dependent on what is your allergen. For example, I'm sitting, like I said, again, I'm going back to the same analogy. I'm sitting in the garden all the time. It's going to itch all the time if I'm allergic to that. So that means what her take-home point in this whole meeting is, in this whole talk is, that treat keratoconus as a systemic allergy issue also, even though they don't have other systemic like asthma and other things. And please work up these factors, especially in a child who comes to you. We don't need IgE for all the people who walk into your clinic. It's a pretty costly test. Mm-hmm. But at least the children less than 14 years who come to you, please get it done, and you'll always find that they have something or the other which can be avoided, like those two cases what she mentioned. And if you don't avoid them, if you do a cross-link, if the allergen is there in the house, it's going to create problem all the time. The only time I tell them to not to avoid something is if they have a pet at home. If I say that you avoid it, many people can abandon or just make the pet orphan, which I don't want to. So otherwise, we have to be a little forceful on avoiding certain things. Sometimes perfumes.
Rohit, what about topical cyclosporins?
Cyclosporins do work because cyclosporin, now we are talking about chloroquine, all these drugs have an act on your T cells. So these are, a lot of them are T cell mediated release. And anti-allergics are your lower stream, downstream. And the lowest downstream is the mediator, that's the mast cell release. So you look at the upstream, these two drugs are upstream, and both of them have a very good role in. Earlier I used to use cyclosporin, now I use chloroquine because it is cheaper and it doesn't sting as much as the cyclosporin is. It's because of the environment and food we eat. The question was, why is it rapidly progressing in children? I said, children, if you go to meet a pediatrician, they will tell you that their asthma is increasing, the bronchial, if you go to the dermatologist will tell you that eczema is increasing. Children in our country are getting more allergic, hypersensitivity to allergy. That is not in ophthalmology. You go to all these branches. I have a pulmonologist who said last 5 years, number of children coming to her with asthma problem has double or triple. So it's because your allergy is increasing, everything else is going to increase. That's because our environment is changing. So the effects of your pollution, your global warming, everything is slowly creeping up, and we are seeing it ourselves. Yes, sir, exactly. Chloroquine drops works again on the immune module. It's an immune modulator, so it is working on the same little different pathway than cyclosporin, but it's more compatible for especially in the children, because for an allergy, 0.05% what we use for dry eye doesn't work. At this point of time, UV lube is only one which is available. UV lube. It's an acute acting drug, so at least twice a day for 4 months. And after 4 months, it's more of an acute phase, so you have to stop it.
Ketorolac?
Tacrolimus.
Yeah, that also works. See, this is a part of the armamentarium. You can use 2% cyclosporin, but that again causes a lot of burning and stinging. The tacrolimus, the ophthalmic ointment, is a little better tolerated. Earlier, we had only the skin ointment, which we used to put outside on the skin and hope that at night it would seep through and give results, which it does do. But now you can put I use the Aurolab, no financial interest, but the Aurolab Taclimint is, I find it better tolerated in the eye. I put it in the eye at night for patients of allergy, for patients of SPKs, and it seems to do tolerate it fairly well.
But how long will you, because it is
3 months again.
Yeah, it's known, tacrolimus for indefinite use is not advised. Because it's known to cause changes. It could even cause cancer, because it's the double-edged sword. So like sir said,
not more than 3 months at a stretch.
Tacrolimus is more potent, you have to use it probably the last line, because or
twice a day chloroquine or once at night tacrolimus.
Yeah. Which one, sir?
It's in low strength. It is available in low strength, 2 strengths.
Entod is making one, if I remember. Entrac is the trade name. Other one is what
there,
you mentioned.
There are, as Aurolab has Taclimint, then there are some other, Telimus by Ajanta Pharma. And now there are many other companies also making it.
Basically, there are a lot of drugs in the market, but we'll have to taper it to what is this? It's more of a bespoke approach, and that is how we need to take. So finally, what do you think? Is this the eye rubbing or which came first? Just to end it.
First came the keratoconus.
Thank you.